The last time I saw my father was in Grand Central Station. I was going from my grandmother's in the Adirondacks to a cottage on the Cape that my mother had rented, and I wrote my father that I would be in New York between trains for half an hour, and asked if we could have lunch together. His secretary wrote to say that he would meet me at the information booth at noon, and at 12 o'clock sharp, I saw him.
Hi, Charlie. Hi, boy. I'd like to take you to my lunch club, but it's in the 60s, and if you have to catch an early train, I guess you better get something to eat around here.
We went from the station up a side street to a restaurant. It was still early, and the place was empty.
Kellner! Carbon, come here, you! Can we have a little service out here? Chop chop!
Were you clapping at me?
Calm down, Sommelier. If it's not too much to ask for, if you wouldn't be above and beyond the call of duty, we would like a couple of beef-eater Gibsons.
I don't like being clapped at.
I should have brought my whistle. I have a whistle that is audible only to the ears of old waiters. Now take out your little pad and your little pencil and see if you can get this straight. Two beef-eater Gibsons. Now repeat after me. Two beef-eater Gibsons.
I think you'd better go somewhere else.
That is one of the most brilliant suggestions I have ever heard. Come on, Charlie. Let's get the hell out of here.
I followed my father out of that restaurant into another one. He was not so boisterous this time. Our drinks came, and he cross-questioned me about the baseball season. He then struck the edge of his empty glass with his knife and began to shout.
Garçon, Kellner, Camerer, you, could we trouble you to bring us two more of the same?
How old is the boy?
That is none of your goddamn business.
I'm sorry, sir, but I won't serve the boy another drink.
Well, I have some news for you. I have some very interesting news for you. This doesn't happen to be the only restaurant in New York. They've opened another on the corner. Come on, Charlie.
He paid the bill, and I followed him out of the restaurant into another. Here the waiters wore pink jackets like hunting coats, and there was a lot of horse tack on the walls. He sat down, and my father began to shout once again.
Master of the hounds, tally-hoo, and all that sort of thing. We'd like a little something in the way of a stirrup cup, namely, two bibs and ghee feeders.
Two bibs and ghee feeders?
You know damn well what I want. I want two bibs and ghee feeders, and make it snappy. Things have changed in a jolly old England, so my friend the Duke tells me. Let's see what England can produce in the way of a cocktail.
This isn't England.
Don't argue with me. Just do as you're told.
I just thought you might like to know where you are.
If there is one thing I cannot tolerate, it is an impudent domestic. Come on, Charlie.
The fourth restaurant we went to was Italian.
Buongiorno. Per favore, possiamo avere due cocktail americani. Forti, molto gin, poco vermouth.
I don't understand Italian.
Oh, come off it. You understand Italian, and you know damn well you do. Vogliamo due cocktail americani, subito.
I'm sorry, sir, but this table is reserved.
All right, get us another table.
All the tables here are reserved.
I get it. You don't desire a patronage. Is that it? Well, the hell with you. Vada Alferno. Let's go, Charlie.
I have to get my train. And without another word, we were off.
Here, I'll get you a train to read on the paper. Kind sir, will you be good enough to favor me one of your goddamn no-good 10-cent afternoon papers? Is it asking too much, kind sir? Is it asking too much for you to sell me one of your disgusting specimens of yellow journalism?
I have to go, Daddy. It's late. Goodbye.
Now, just wait a second, Sonny. Just wait a second. I want to get a rise out of this chap.
I walked away and never saw my father again.